Hello everyone, I'm Trey Rich and you're watching The Buzz. Today we have an all-female show with Kat Cunnings, Chrissy Stokes, then from this season of The Voice, Tamara Jade, and from Netflix Grand Army, Marcela Avelina. That's right, it's ladies night, so let's get this party started.
Hi, my name is Kat Cunning and let's get buzzed.
Starting off the show, we have Kat Cunning, whose infectious voice will soon lead her to chart-topping success. On October 30th, she's gonna drop a remix with her song Supernova with Paris. Let's check her out.
Hi, I am Kat Cunning. My cat might make a cameo in this, and I'm so excited to be here. I started as a dancer for the majority of my life, and then I told my dance company that I could sing in an effort to keep my job, and that was only a small number of years ago, I think like 5 years ago. And I sang in that show, and I was totally making it up as I went along, and I was the indie girl in the show, and it went well. So I'm still singing now. I started writing soon after that. I think that from that first endorsement from the Times, the New York Times said I was a good singer. Say hello to Huli Cat. She's going to get out of here now. Love you. The New York Times said that I was a good singer, and I think that was a really helpful endorsement for people to want to start writing with me. And yeah, from my end, it still feels slow, you know, because you write a million songs and you release one every once in a while. So I've been lucky for the pace, but it's still just, I'm working at it every day. Like I said, I became a singer while performing. So I worked on singing while gigging. I was gigging a lot in New York City, in nightlife and in concert dance companies and stuff like that. So a lot of it was output and performing while I was learning my craft. So this has been a really cool opportunity for me to slow down a little bit and think about what I want to say in my songs and have a little bit more of my introverted side come through in my art. I was lucky to be in a position where I actually got signed during quarantine with Lava Records. So I wasn't, I had a single in line and all the timing worked out for me. I got a good break to focus on protesting, honestly, and participating in the world, and I didn't have a huge conflict of whether or not my song was right to put out at the moment. But for artists around me who were having that issue, I feel like I felt really grounded in the fact that people always need art, and pop music is this funny niche where sometimes all you're singing about is a wet-ass pussy. I don't know if you have to censor that, but that the world needs that too. The world needs an escape from how dark everything is. I mean, we aren't all politicians, and we're in a funny place right now where every artist feels suddenly like we have to step up and be the president because our president isn't doing that. But I feel like whatever you do, whatever your voice is in pop, whether it's really, really fluffy or really, really political, it's still important. People need a rom-com as much as they need a movie about the war. You be the hero and I'll be the shrew. Calling my name from the tracks where I leave you. The trouble is, baby, they know it's a play. The release that I just had was a song called Supernova, and it is about love, and it's about sort of walking into the fire even though you think your heart's gonna get broken. The fire of a supernova, which is a star exploding in space. And I know that that's how love feels like for me sometimes when I'm attracted to somebody. There's just like this beautiful, destructive thing, and we've all had that one love story, or if you haven't, you probably will. But I felt like it was a joyful statement to put out and something that was about, you know, trying even in dark times and even when things feel dark. And it was really, really special for me to get to release it in the time that I did, because we just like at the very end of the super long quarantine got to go make this video now that we had finally had protocols for everyone being in masks and being tested properly. And for me, it was like so many of the videos I've made or records I've cut are like in a rush. Because you're touring and then you stop for one day to cut it, or it all just comes together very, very last minute. And while this video was still kind of made in 2 weeks, I feel like everything about it, we all had the energy of the pandemic and we wanted to see each other, and we wanted to, for me, it felt like performing, and that's my lifeblood. And I got to perform the shit out of this song. And the remix is really exciting for me because I think that the song itself is quite, a lot of people interpret it being a really happy sentiment, just like my sweet Supernova, like the person who's really, really important to me. And I love that the song can universally translate that way, or if you listen closer to the lyrics, you know it's more about heartbreak and destruction. But the remix leans a lot more into that side of things. It's a little darker and harder, and it's more about the heartbreak for me and the danger of the particular love story I was writing at the time.
I was afraid of real things, and I couldn't get to sleep to dream. My mom came out, and I was mean. I said, what a slap in the face.
I'm really lucky to have something that I filmed that will still be coming out soon. It's a J-Lo movie called Marry Me, and I'm so excited to be an actor anywhere near J-Lo because she's sort of my career icon for coming from dance and then beasting it as an actor and a musician. So that's a really, really big thing coming up. But as for like day-to-day, I think we're all just creatively figuring out how to translate this craft. I hope to see some outdoor type performances where everybody social distances, because like I said, I live for performance and the connection between the audience and the performer. So I'm waiting for those things to pop up and I'll be a part of them. New fans can follow me at Instagram at Kat Cunning, and that's pretty much where I live. But I'm also on Twitter. I'm also learning TikTok, and it's Kat Cunning across the board. Come hang out with me. Hi, my name is Kat Cunning, and you've just been buzzed.
Supernova is out now on all streaming platforms, so be sure to add it to your playlist. After the break, we have the season's voice standout, Tamara Jade, so don't go anywhere.
Never been in love before. What the hell are stupid feelings, yo? Once upon a time, I was on go.
It's been 19 seasons, and NBC's singing competition, The Voice, is still going strong. Each season, the talent seems to be getting better and better, and this season is on par to be the tightest competition yet. That being said, Tamara Jade impressed the judges enough to get a four-chair turnaround, and was the first to be featured on the show. Early predictions say she's a finalist for sure. Let's take a look.
My name is Tamara Jade. I actually just turned 31 last week, and I'm originally from Bowie, Maryland.
I'm crying 'cause I love you.
I did not expect any of this. I really did not. And to have the video, they leaked the video last week. I didn't, to be honest, I had a virtual concert that day. The day they leaked it was my birthday. Okay. It was my actual birthday. And so I was doing a virtual concert. And almost as soon as the concert finished streaming, I started getting these text messages and this flood. And I'm like, what's going on? And they're like, the whole audition is up except for who you chose. And I'm like, what? You know? And so just everything, It just has been a snowball effect of just so much love and support. Actually, I was scheduled to be on tour with Corey Henry and the Funk Apostles opening for Lenny Kravitz this summer. So the reality is if COVID didn't happen, I probably wouldn't even be able to have auditioned for the show. So it's kind of a blessing and a curse because it's obviously we don't want to celebrate any sickness or death. But because of this, I had the time to really kind of divert from being a background singer and invest this time into myself. So there was a lot of restrictions, a lot of social distancing. The stages are different. You know, just a lot of masks, putting on makeup, getting all beat, and then putting the mask on top of it. So yeah, that the COVID definitely has had a hand in how this whole thing worked. And I just eventually kind of figured it wasn't going to happen. They were just going to cancel the season. And then with about 3 weeks time, within about 3 weeks of us leaving, we got the emails and the calls that we were invited. And my whole family, we were very nervous. We were very, very, very nervous. I must have had on 3 layers of clothing and a face shield and a mask underneath and gloves. And my mom gave me food from home and she was like, don't eat no food on the plane, you know? So, but everything worked out and it worked out well. I'm very into God's timing and what the universe communicates to you, and being in tune with just the path being illuminated. So for me, I make those decisions when they come to me. I can't say whether or not I would have gone one way or another, because like touring is fun. And the reality is my goal and my dream is to be a working musician, is to be an artist. But sometimes those two things do compete, you know, and it comes down to like, do you want to know how you're paying your bills, or do you want to hope for the best? Right. And so I don't know which way I would have gone, but I think in this case, God made it very, very clear what direction I needed to go in. And I think the results are the fruits of that decision being the right decision. You know, in these scenarios, we all get very invested and we all have very strong opinions about what we think is best for people. And I'm like a full-on believer of self-awareness and self-advocacy. And in that moment, no matter what people think you should do, the decision entirely rests on your shoulders. And so what it all really boiled down to was listening to the feedback in real time, and also thinking for myself about my career versus the competition. Because they are not synonymous at every point in time. Sometimes, you know, you make decisions for one and not the other. It's the same thing as being a working musician versus an artist. Like, what am I, the working musician as well as the competition is a right now thing, but your career as well as your artistry is a part of your legacy. And so for me in that moment, I chose the person who I felt could best help me leave the type of legacy that I'm working towards, and who could give me the feedback, the coaching, the mentoring that would help me in the long term. Because the reality is, and a lot of people may interpret this however they want to, I know who I am and I know that I'm very good at what I do. So any one of those people can help me get to the next phase of where I'm going. But for me, what it really boiled down to is, who understands the type of person I am? Who understands my walk? Who has done what it is that I want to do? And when it boiled down to it, John Legend was the one that really stuck out. And even in their feedback to me, Blake's feedback was, artist to artist, you shouldn't pick me, but coach to artist, I can help you win this. That's a right now thing. When Stefani was, I can help you with the rap singing. You know, I've had a contestant who is similar to you, and you know, right now thing. Kelly Clarkson, as I said back to her, you are the first to ever do it, and so you know how to navigate a competition like this, a right now thing. But John and I connected on things that actually kind of reach beyond the competition, and I think I made the right decision. And to be honest, I saw him in 2017 at the Darkness and Light tour at Madison Square Garden, and it was the first time I believed that I could be on stages like that. I convinced myself that nobody would want to see me and my loud self jump around on a stage that large. And when I saw his show, how masterfully it was put together and how moving it was, and how still very much true to him and his beliefs it was, I was like, yeah, I can do that. So this has been a long time coming, and I believe it's destiny and I believe it's fate, and I'm excited. Yes, so on every platform, my name is Tamara Jade Music, and it is pronounced Tamara like camera, but it is not spelled like camera. It's spelled Tamara Jade Music on all social media platforms. Please go ahead and link me there. I'm very active. I'm very engaged. It's me talking to you. It's not a robot. It's not, you know, a staff yet. But I do have music available everywhere you stream or buy music as well. Please run up these numbers on this YouTube. YouTube is almost up to 1 million views on this audition. Facebook is over 2 million. So run these numbers up for your girl. Yeah, and that's where you can find me, and continue to watch the show this season. Tune in. There's some really, really awesome, talented contestants with amazing stories that I think are going to reach a lot of people. Hi, my name is Tamara Jade, and you've just been buzzed.
You can watch this season of The Voice Mondays and Tuesdays on NBC, so check your local listings. Don't go anywhere, because in our studio we have Chrissy. We'll be back after this.
Always here for me, wanted nothing from me. God knows I can count on you. That one friend that was always here for me.
Chrissy Stokes is the daughter of hip-hop and R&B super producer and creator of the iconic You Got Served dance movie, Chris Stokes. Chrissy has now taken all that experience and applied it to her new project called Taken. We have her in our studio now to talk about growing up hip-hop for real. Let's check it out.
Hi everybody, I'm Chrissy, and I'm an artist, and I'm an actress.
Here's the years of loyalty. You were always there supporting me. Even when I messed up, kept it real with me. You never gave up on what you sing. That one friend that was always here for me. Wanted nothing from me. God knows I can count on you. That one friend that was always here for me. Only wanted honesty. God knows I can count on you. Yeah, I pray for you and yours every day, yeah, blessings.
My dad's Chris Stokes, so I grew up around it. So, I mean, it's just like second nature to me. So when the bug hit me, I would say I was around 9, but I was too nervous to go to my dad because I was like, I had too much pressure because he discovered so many different people. I was like, I don't want to say nothing yet. And then when I got 11 is when I was like, Dad, I think I want to do this, like, acting and singing stuff. And he was like, no. I just kept being adamant. And then he finally just, he loosened up to me. It all started with the quarantine, okay? Soon as that quarantine happened, I started getting creative and writing and doing my whole little thing. And then my dad was like, let's just do one. Let's put an album in the can real quick. And then we did it. I felt like it was the right time when I started getting more of my creative musical vibe. During the quarantine, it felt like the perfect time to just like put everything into my music.
You working hard every day, baby, I see you. It takes a hustle to do all the things that you do. You turn me on every day.
The thing about me is I'm just like super free and I just do what I want when I want. I'm pretty sporadic. I don't really like plan stuff. I just do it. So, Relax, the single. It's about my lover, my hubby. And the whole album is kind of about him, but it also is about like my past, some heartache, some heartbreak, Signs, No More Games. Like there's certain songs on there that talks about like heartache and heartbreak too. So not only is there lovey-dovey, there's some like, you know, am I feeling type ones too. Anxiety is a real thing. So when I like get in there and I start writing and I get into my element and into my zone, it's like nothing else exists in the world. When I'm writing and in the studio and recording. Cause sometimes, you know, all girls go through their little heartbreak. So my little, you know, 16-year-old heartbreak, I still can write about that because I still can tap into those feelings.
I wanna be first priority. Not a second choice, but first priority. Never care to cling, but I love your energy. Make me feel important, stimulate me mentally. We all want love sometimes.
So the first song I ever wrote was not at a young age. The first time song I ever wrote was 17 years old. And it's called Butterflies. And it's actually on SoundCloud. And the name of the mixtape was 17. And I wrote every song on there. Yeah.
Distractions. Show me how important I am.
I don't even know what's next. Like I said, I'm sporadic. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm just going with the flow. See where it takes me. We got 15 songs, and then we got 10 music videos. So, almost a music video for every song. A lot of people feel pressured to talk about what everybody else is talking about, but I just talked about what I feel like I can relate to. So, the single's already out, Relax. And Relax is just like telling your man to just come home, sit back, relax. You've been working hard, kick your feet up. Let me take care of you for a change for when you come home after work. So that's kind of what it's talking about. And Taken is out October 16th. And I think you're gonna love it. So, in the quarantine, once again, me and my homegirl Maya, were just like chilling at the house, and I was like, you know what, because we had started the quarantine together, so I was like, you know what, you want to do some YouTube videos? She was like, yeah, let's do it. So we would just start doing our YouTube video, doing our little tutorials and stuff, because I wanted people to like get to know me, because I feel like people just see like my face on Instagram, but they don't see like my personality. So I want people to like see me and know who I am. The quarantine got the brain flowing, got the fingers, yeah, got the fingers going.
Quarantine, I don't know what.
That's what I need to name it, huh? Yeah, quarantine. Quarantine Cosmetics. So on all social media platforms, it is I am Chrissy 97. So I am Chrissy 97, and then Snapchat is Chrissy Stokes 15. So hit me up, DM me. I like to respond to DMs. And yeah, hi, I'm Chrissy, and you've just been buzzed.
Taken is out now on all streaming platforms, and you can go check out her music videos on YouTube right now. We still got more to go with Marcela Avelina to talk about her new music and her new Netflix series, Grand Army. We'll be right back. Marcela Avelina is making her TV debut as Flora Mejia in Netflix's highly anticipated young adult drama series, Grand Army, based on Katie Capiello's play Slut, in which Marcela also starred. Marcela also has some new music that just dropped called Took Me Out, and she's up next to tell us all about it, so let's take a look.
Hi, I'm Marcela Avelina.
I thought if I could just keep focusing on you, things could be different.
Off of Grand Army, start calling it like it is.
I play Flora in Grand Army, and she is a senior at Grand Army, and she's in a relationship with Sid. And she's super smart and ambitious and vulnerable. And I got the part, I was in Slut the Play, which is what Grand Army is based on. It's kind of an expanded universe based off of Slut. And I was in the original cast of Slut the Play by Katie Capiello. And I knew that Katie had been working on the series, and then last spring she had a table read, and she had kind of a bunch of old students and people in her circle come and read the full script. And I was a part of that table read. But I actually didn't read for Flora. Flora at the time was written differently. But I was at the reading, and I was just happy to be there because Katie Capiello, anything she touches is just magic. And then shortly after the table read, they let me know that they wanted to rewrite a part for me and have me come in on an audition. And so I auditioned for four, and then basically it follows five characters at Grand Army, and they're facing different issues like racism and sexual assault and struggling with sexuality, bullying, kind of finding your identity. And through these five characters, we kind of learn their webs, and it spreads and spreads. It's a really big cast, because obviously there's so many kids in public schools a lot of the time in New York City. So kind of the how all those stories are interwoven. And yeah, when I read the script for the first time, I couldn't believe how accurate it was. Like, Katie does such a brilliant job of really capturing what it's like to go to school in New York City, and also just in general. Like, I feel like the further we get from adolescence, we tend to dehumanize teenagers. And like young people know what's up. Like, racism, sexual violence, all these things, these are not issues that are exclusive to adults. This is not, these issues are not exclusive to a certain age demographic. So I think the show does a really brilliant job of being authentic and showing people that young people are living fully realized lives, if that makes sense.
Some days I still feel you here. Are you that far gone?
I started writing songs when I was like 11. So I feel like I have trouble with this because I don't I would consider myself an R&B artist, and I think that's where people tend to, what category people tend to put me in. But I can't tell if that's just what people have told me that I am, and if that's how I feel. Like, I'm so influenced by so many different types of music. Like, the earliest artist that I can remember being obsessed with, like, if I think, like, way back in the deepest memory that I have, like, the two artists that come to mind are Rod Stewart and TLC.
The biscuit me, it honestly took me out. I wouldn't have felt it, but I see how you let me drown. The biscuit hit me.
Yeah, my single took me out. It's my first single off an album that I've been working on for a while now. I'm really excited for this to come out because I feel like it's definitely different than anything I've ever done. I wrote it kind of at peak quarantine when we were all locked in our houses. I'd come up with this bass part that I just kept thinking about, and then I made a Logic file on my computer and then threw the vocal over it. Kind of happened simultaneously. And I knew that I wanted like a kind of a pulsing backbeat feel to it. And so I kind of added a mock beat over that, and then once it was, you know, safe to meet with my band, to meet with my co-producers, we kind of started layering the track. And I'm inspired by a lot of different artists, and I tend to just like go with, I'm never trying to like, okay, I want to make this kind of song, if that makes sense. And I'm on Instagram, I'm on all the things, Spotify, Apple Music, everything. Marcela Avelina, so that's one L, and Marcela, one L, and Avelina, it's all under that name. Hi, I'm Marcela Avelina, and you just been blessed.
That's all we have. Special thanks to Marcela Avelina, Chrissy Stokes, Tamara Jade, NBC, The Voice, and Kat Cunning. Don't forget to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and double tap us on Instagram, all at @buzz_access. We're still in a pandemic, so again, please make sure you're being safe. I'm Trey Rich, love and light to you all. Get out and vote.
I wanna be first priority. Not a second choice, but first priority. Never care to clean, but I love your energy. Make me feel important, stimulate me mentally. We all want love sometimes. Real love is what you can't buy.
For more stories and extended clips, go to thebuzzallaccess.com. I'm Trey Rich, and you've just been buzzed.